Okay, so thank you very much for having the paper in the program. This is co-author work with Thiago Cavalcanti from Cambridge and Georgi Kosherkov from Constance. I'm Cezar Santos from the Getulio Vargas Foundation in Rio. So I'm gonna talk about family planning and development aggregate effects of contraceptive use. So these two warnings, this is very much work in progress, so comments are welcome. And the second warning is that this is a macro paper. So, but the idea goes back to a paper by Gary Becker in 1960 that he talks about the quantity-quality trade-off. And then he says that families with excess children would spend less on each child than other families. Accordingly, an increase in contraceptive knowledge would raise the quality of children as well as reduce their quantity. So we're going to take this idea here and bring it to a macro model. Think about the macro economy. Like in countries where access to contraceptive are harder, what happens to the quantity and quality of children and how that affects the country's income and human capital. So just by way of introduction, so let me tell you two things. So fertility is at least partially stochastic. We see some data on unwanted fertility as well as contraception use, abortions. So there's some aspect that's random about fertility. And also, once parents have children, excuse me, the next step is usually to provide them with education, and education is costly, both in terms of time and in terms of money. So the story that I tell my mom is that, look, I want to have two kids and send them to college, but if I have three and I cannot afford college for all three, they're going to stop at high school, and that's going to decrease the average education of my children. So this is the idea, but we want to take that to the macroeconomy. So if in countries where parents make a lot of mistakes, as in they have excess children, the educational attainment of children may be lower than desired, and income and output may also be lower. So that is the idea that we want to focus in this paper. And in order to do that, we're going to build a dynamic equilibrium model to assess this question. Before I, let me just show you some data, some regressions. And these are not fancy regressions by any stretch of the imagination. So this is data from the Demographic and Health Surveys, the DHS. So these are some cross-country regressions. So I'm going to show you two tables. This first one is kind of like the obvious one. So the dependent variable is unwanted fertility. So for the fertility gap, so the realized fertility minus wanted fertility. And we're regressing that against the use of modern contraception by women. This is a cross-country. Yeah, so the DHS already gives me that, but you can get the macro data for the DHS as well. But here we're doing, it's a very simple cross-country regression. Some countries we see them more than once as well.
So women who already completed their fertility?
Yes, yes. This is like you talk to 45. We have exactly what the question is in the appendix of the paper, where it's something like you ask 45 to 49 year old women how many kids they had over their life, how many they originally wanted, things like that. So that's the dependent variable, the unwanted fertility or fertility gap. I'm going to use both against the use of modern contraception. So what this says is that this coefficient is negative. So all of this is saying is that in countries where more women use contraception, unwanted fertility, so the fertility gap is lower. Okay, so that sounds pretty obvious to me. The second one, it's closer to what we're doing in the paper, which is how unwanted fertility is correlated with human capital attainment in the country. Okay, so in countries where unwanted fertility is higher, the coefficient is negative, so in countries where unwanted fertility is higher, human capital attainment is lower, even after you control also for wanted fertility. So what we're going to do in the paper, so when we think about quantity qual trade-off, we think about people choosing to have more or less children educating more or less. Here, what you're saying is that, yes, they do that. The coefficient of wanted fertility is negative, but also there's some there's something else going on with the unwanted children part of the story. So what we do? So we're going to build an equilibrium overlapping generations model in which we're going to have endogenous and stochastic fertility and human capital accumulation. We're going to calibrate the model to Kenyan data and perform some counterfactuals. Just to give you some numbers, so the benchmark here is the Kenyan economy as it is today. So going from the benchmark economy to a scenario in which parents could perfectly choose their number of children, the GDP per capita would increase 13%. If we think about two extreme scenarios, one in which there's no family planning whatsoever, and the other one being you have perfect fertility choice, GDP per capita would increase by 30%. And also, we're going to have both contraceptive methods and abortions in the model, and contraceptive methods seem more effective at bridging this gap, if you will.
So by no family planning, just mean natural fertility that would occur in the population, like the Hutterites or something. I'm just trying to get an idea. That could be like 13 children per family or something.
So. Okay, no family planning, I mean no access to contraceptive methods, no access to abortions or anything like that. You can still...
But you can still reduce your sexual activity.
You can, yes.
Right. Okay.
Yes, that's what I mean. Okay. So there's a huge, this is a very, very, just a few papers that are related to what we're doing. I mean, it's not supposed to be all the papers are related to the literature, of course. We talk about a lot more in the paper. But it's, of course, related to, so as I said, in the quote in the first slide, this idea goes back to this paper 1960 by Becker. There's also some macro models like Barrow-Becker, Galler-Weil. There are some papers that talk about differential fertility, like Delacroix and Dobkin Fogel. And also Baudin, Delacroix, and Gobi, that they talk about unwanted fertility, but they're thinking about something else, that very, very poor people like with bad nutrition that want to have children and can't. And for them, education is exogenous, which is something that we're obviously interested. There's some experiments and also some papers that talk about contraception use. In economics, a lot of them, most of them, three quarters of these focus on the effects on female labor force participation, and my co-author Georgi also talks about abortions and affecting inequality. So everything I talk about abortions, Georgi is our, Korsakov is our in-house expert for abortions. So let me go straight into the model, but before I talk about the full model that we're going to take to the data, I'm going to, in order to clarify some ideas, I'm going to show you a toy model. So in this toy model, there's going to be a representative agent. So we're going to have heterogeneity in the full model. There's going to be no uncertainty in fertility. People have access to contraception, but there's no abortion. So this setup is going to be very similar throughout the two models. So it's an overlapping generations model, as I said. People live for three periods. First, they're children, and they don't do anything. Young adults, who are going to do everything here, and old adults. So the young adults are going to make a fertility contraception decision. They're going to decide how much education to give to their children and save for old age. Old adults consume their savings and die. The supply side of the economy is going to be very simple, just a representative firm with a Cobb-Douglas production function that uses capital and labor. Now, the households. So little n is going to be the number of children that these guys have. Q is going to be the choice of contraception. If you don't use any contraception, you're going to have big N. So big N is the maximum number of children you can have. And that's not a choice for now. It's just the maximum number of children. You can have less children by using some contraception. Q. The human capital of the children, H prime, is just E is education. So the parents pay for some education, and the children have some human capital. In the preferences for the household is consumption when young, consumption when old, the number of children, human capital of their children. They consume, save. Here is the cost of contraception. So they choose Q, units of contraception, at the price phi Q. And they pay for the education of their children. H is their human capital. W is the price of an efficiency unit of labor. And this chi here is the time that you spend raising each child.
So no interaction here between quantity and quality in the utility function, only the preference.
Yes.
Also only the
sorry?
Only the budget constraint.
Only the budget constraint. So here there's no uncertainty, right? So there's no realization of anything. So you, yeah?
So there are, okay, so I thought Q was giving you a probability of.
No. Here I choose Q in order to choose the number of children. I choose E in order to the, for now, I choose it perfectly, okay? What I'm gonna do in this toy model is very simple. I'm gonna play around with this price here, just to see how these guys respond. In the full model, we're going to have some random aspects to it. OK, so this is very simple. I can solve it by hand. So this is the formula for the number of children. First, if contraception is free, so these guys can go at the first best number of children they have. So if contraception is free, this disappears. Income disappears here. This is just a constant. And this is just because children are a normal good. When the price changes, you have an income and substitution effect. And my utility is log here. Okay. So if these guys have perfect access to contraception, they're going to choose their optimal number of children, their first best. If the price of contraception is positive, so it's costly contraception, then fertility decreases with income. So here in this toy version of the model, this is the guy that generates a quantity quality trade-off. Without it, you just go into the first best number of children. OK, so the way it's going to work is that, so you, which is this guy here, which is the optimal number of children. I can't reach it. So the number of children that you're going to have is going to be between this guy and the maximum number of children and big N. And what's going to happen is that there's going to be a threshold of the capital stock in the economy that, of course, is a function of the price of contraceptions, such that if the economy is poorer than that, people are not going to use any contraception, and fertility is just going to be the maximum number of children you can have. Now, if the economy is richer than that, then fertility is lower. And this threshold moves with the price of contraception in the usual way. So if the price of contraception goes up, the economy needs to be richer in order for fertility to start declining. And also, if you are in that situation where fertility is declining, as I said in words, fertility declines with capital accumulation, which is exactly what I just said here. OK, so wherever you start, there's a unique equilibrium path that will get you to the steady state. So you get the steady state here that's called K star. If the price of contraception is sufficiently small, then fertility decreases with the price of contraception, and family interventions that reduce the price of modern contraception, they increase the steady state level of capital. Okay, so here, if contraception is cheaper, the economy is going to be richer, the steady state level of physical capital is going to be higher, but not only physical capital, also human capital, because human capital increases with physical capital. So in a world where contraception technology is cheaper, we're going to have a lower quantity of children, higher quality of children, and the economy is going to be richer. Okay? Which is, the simple model is consistent with those simple regressions I showed you in the first few slides. Now, for this toy model here, there's no heterogeneity, there's no fertility uncertainty, so we're going to enrich this model a little bit in order to take it to the data for some quantitative analysis.
But do you have a sense of what those regressions that you showed at the beginning are for the data that you're going to use for the model?
What?
I mean, what's the fertility market like in Kenya? I just don't know if this is if the models need to be consistent with that. Is there like sex selection of parents, selective abortion?
So we have data. I'll show you later. So we have data on abortions, on contraception use for these guys by different education levels and things like that, which I'm going to have in the model. And given the heterogeneity in the model, I want my model to be consistent with that. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have a question. On your very first table, I seem to remember that the impact. But can you put the very first table you want? This one, yes. If you look at the column one, you don't put a country fixed effect, and then the impact is not significant, right?
Right.
Parental contraception. It's significant when you put a country fixed effect, which seems to suggest that your story is more a story of what's going on within the country than what's going on across the country. Am I right?
Yeah, so... there are a lot of things that change across countries here, right? Maybe, you know, religion or whatever that I have nothing to say about, right? So in fact, I'm not doing any cross-country comparisons. I'm going to take one country. Okay?
Fine.
Why exactly Kenya?
I don't have a good answer for that. What we wanted was a country with good data. Kenya has the data we need for the demographic and health surveys. We wanted a poor country. Kenya is poor. I don't have a better answer than that. Okay. So let's go to the richer model. So as I said, The setup of the model is going to be very similar. So three periods of life again, children, young adults, old adults. Young adults make all of the decisions we want here. So then here there's fertility, contraception, and abortion decision. Children's education, savings, and old adults consume their savings. Note that they have both contraception and abortions. But this is a non-trivial decision between the two. Contraception, it's something that you decide before any uncertainty. Now we're going to have uncertainty, so contraception you have to pay no matter what. Abortions, of course, it's an ex post decision. The supply side of the economy is very simple and just the same as before. Okay, the production function is very similar. The utility function is very similar to what we had before. So here we're just going to have, there's going to be some disutility of both contraception use and abortion, which is the psi. So phi is the price, the monetary price of contraception and abortions, and psi is the psychic utility cost of it.
But Cezar, the production function is there to get the production function that you have there. So A is going to be exogenous.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's going to any limitation of population, any counterfactual that you're going to find will depend on whether A is an endogenous and recurring seismic, right? And so, for example, think of a runner model in which A is actually endogenous.
Mm-hmm.
A depends on, there's a fixed cost, like, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then this would be a lower bound, though.
I don't know if it's a lower bound either. I think so. But yeah, I'm not endogenizing the TFP here. But which channel are you thinking about endogenizing? So what Chris is saying is that could be a lower bound if what I'm going to get is that, you know, we're going to give more access to contraception to these guys. The quantity is going to go down. Quality is going to go up. If the TFP is a positively correlated function with the human capital, that's going to be a bigger kick. I guess that's Chris's point.
Except that the greater the population, the higher the benefit of actually coming up with new technologies. In your case, I don't know.
So you're talking about a scale effect.
Yeah, I'm talking about a scale effect. So your model doesn't allow for a scale effect.
My model does not allow for scale effects. No, that's true.
Yeah. So that's why I don't know if it's a lower bound.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
If contraceptive use encourages women to work, that also contributes to productivity.
If say that again, please.
If access to contraception encourages women's labor supply.
I'm gonna have the effect. So I don't have men and women separately here. I just have the household making a decision, but as I showed before, so the more kids you have, the lower is going to be the labor supply, right? So this is here mechanically like this. Yeah. Okay.
And where heterogeneity comes from? You said there will be heterogeneity, so what's heterogeneity?
One slide. So number of pregnancies. So P is the number of pregnancies. N tilde here is a chosen number of pregnancies. So if we had no uncertainty, which is going to be this max here, so pregnancy would be exactly wanted fertility. Okay. Now, what we have here is that we have this eta, which is a fertility shock. It's a random variable. So you may have more kids than what you initially wanted. You can insure against these shocks by using the contraception queue. Okay? Then you're going to end up with P pregnancies, which you may decide to abort some of them, and N is the number of children you're going to raise. Okay? Now, human capital. So human capital of the children, H prime, is going to be some shock, epsilon, and some function that depends on the education. Okay. So here, the education, it's very simple. It's H0 plus H1 education. So just note that there is this no homotheticity here, H0, right? So if you look at richer parents, what's going to happen is that as you get richer, the marginal utility of the quality of children will decrease at a slower pace than the number of children. Okay, so this is going to generate the quantity-quality trade-off on top of the phi q that, and this I didn't have before because otherwise I wouldn't have closed form solution.
So what would be the role of infant mortality here?
Of
infant mortality.
There's no infant mortality here, and I could add infant mortality here if the support of this guy could go negative and I took the max out. Okay, I'm not doing that just because when we look at the data for all of the education classes that I'm going to look at, these guys always make a mistake upward. So, but I could add that.
The realization of eta,
yeah,
is completely before the investment in the human capital of the children.
Yes.
But if we think in a more dynamic sort of Kunia-Hedman technology of skill formation, it could probably be the case that you need to start investing on the kids before the realization of the unwanted fertility shocks come along.
Yes.
Especially if you think the first few years are important, right?
Yes, for everything you said. But no, we're not doing it. Yeah, so here, where's the human capital? It's as simple as it gets here. So there's no dynamics essentially. Okay, so as I was saying, so this H0 guy here, it's going to control the quantity quality trade-off that I have in my model. And but you know, as parents get richer, they're going to substitute quantity for quality.
What's the interpretation of the epsilon? Do the parents know the epsilon?
They do. I'm going to talk about the epsilon right now. So the epsilon is here for two reasons. Okay. So yes, the parents know about epsilon, but that doesn't matter because of my utility function. Okay. So that's a cheap trick, just so that it doesn't matter. So why is the epsilon here? So the epsilon here is for two reasons. One, it's going to generate some added heterogeneity. So if I have rich parents, you know, not every children of a rich parent is going to look exactly the same. So that's one reason why the epsilon is there. I guess I said that. It's a shock. That's one reason why it's there. And the second reason why it's there, it's more of a technical thing. So imagine there are like rich and poor parents, and or educated, like no education, and poor parents always have a lot more kids. Okay, if that happens asymptotically, I'm just going to have poor people. And what this epsilon does is that it creates a mix, and then I'm going to have a nice stationary distribution in equilibrium. Okay, so let me show you the value function. So, right. So this is the this is the only source of heterogeneity. It's going to be here. As you start, the family starts their life. That's the only thing here is the human capital. Okay, so that's the only state variable here.
But that's basically the accumulation of these epsilon shocks over generations.
Yes, if there's going to be some intergenerational persistence here, right? So yeah. Okay. So every decision here is done by the young adults. So I'm going to show you their problem. So they start their life with their human capital level. So that's the, as I was telling, as is the only thing that differs. So they're going to choose N tilde, which is the wanted fertility, and Q, which is the contraception decision. And then the continuation value here is, so V tilde is like after, so V is before the uncertainty is realized, V tilde is after the uncertainty is realized. So I'm going to show you this value function in the next slide. But then we need to take an expectation over the shocks, the fertility shocks that these guys are going to have, and the number of pregnancies that they're going to have is going to look like that function that I showed you before. If they do decide to use some contraception, remember there is a utility cost of doing so.
Sorry, I think I missed something.
Yeah.
They're not choosing any savings out of the capital?
They're going to choose savings here. Okay, I'm just separating into. Okay, so let me show you exactly that, the V tilde function. So here, it's everything else. Okay, so they have some human capital, the number of pregnancies, and the contraception they use. The contraception is here just because they have to pay for it. So they're going to choose consumption when young, consumption when old, savings, abortions, and education for their children. Okay, the utility function, the one I showed you, if they do abort some, they have some utility cost. So there's consumption, saving. Here's the expenditures on contraception, expenditures on abortions, expenditures on education, and their income is W is the efficiency unit, efficiency wage per efficiency unit of labor. H is the number of efficiency units they have, and this is their labor supply. As I was telling her, Sonia, the more children they have, the less time they spend in the labor market. But then the number of children they're going to have it's the number of pregnancies minus abortions, and they like the children just as much, okay? And then they have also the production function of human capital of their children. And that's it. Okay, it's a very simple model.
Clarify the difference between your setup, say, and Barrow Becker, one of the papers you put up. I mean, they're the ideal and equilibrium model with quantity quality trade, right? So, I'm just curious, what are you adding to that?
The uncertainty. Yes. That's the one thing that let me go back, since we're talking about Becker, let me go back to his quote. That's what we are interested in this paper, is increased contraception knowledge, contraception access in preventing this excess number of children. That's it. We're going to play around with access to contraception to see what happens to human capital, income, so on and so forth.
Well, I mean, I guess it's a question. That's okay. I don't want to get attached to it, but I'm just curious. Knowledge there, I just might be.
Yeah.
I'm richer and I get access to, you know, fertility clinics and things like that. As opposed to here, your knowledge is kind of uncertainty related to the stochastic process of reproduction. I'm just trying to understand what you mean by knowledge.
What does he mean by knowledge? What do I mean by knowledge? So here. Here it's not knowledge. Here for me it's access, and I'm going to model access as the price of contraception and abortions. So if I make this, if I make these prices infinitely large, there's nothing you can do about those fertility shocks. And then I'm going to see what happens in the macroeconomy.
But there is kind of like this foreign non-consumption that's going on, right? The Becker Barrow framework, right? And the more children you have, right, then the lower the quality, and that lowers your utility. Right. So I mean, there is, you know, that's the quantity quality trade-off that I think Flavio was looking for earlier.
But we are going to have that, right? Even in the toy model, when there is no uncertainty.
That's why I'm trying to understand exactly the difference. I mean, it's not that I'm not saying you don't have it.
Right.
I'm not quite sure how. What do we learn from this as opposed to Barrow Becker?
So what I'm going to do, okay. So what I'm going to do here is that I'm going to use my model as a measurement device to try to get at the quantitative importance of this access to contraception technology. That's what I'm going to do with the model. Okay, so contraception here is going to be good. It's an option I'm giving you. The question here is quantitative. I mean, how important is that?
Is the difference that you have a technology here where going from desired number of children to actual number of children is stochastic, and the mechanism that controls that is the contraception?
Right.
And is that what's different from Barrow Becker?
Yeah, there's no uncertainty.
You're adding uncertainty alone. With Barrow Becker would be interesting. Now, but you're also adding it in the stochastic reproduction. You could just put uncertainty generally about, you know, utility, I mean, consumption flows and earnings.
Oh, yeah, okay.
So in other words, I'm just trying to clarify.
Okay. Is it clear?
Well, I guess I'm adding, what's the marginal value added? Maybe you'll say that at the end. I mean, you could calibrate Barrow Becker, right?
Right.
I'm just curious, what if I did that as opposed to your setup?
But
I mean, they're going to have like a cost of a child. But
right.
Part of that would probably, they'd say, well, the contraception cost is part of the cost of the child, right?
You're looking at the mechanism of how that.
Exactly. So
enters through contraception.
Right.
No, I understand. Very special mechanism. I'm just trying to see what I gain. So, okay. I just say the price of a child has gone up, right?
Yeah.
I mean, supposing I have a mechanism where the wage of women goes up, like Sonia was talking about, for example, then basically the opportunity cost of time has gone up, right? And therefore, it's, let's say, the fertility. That's a process. Fertility becomes costly.
Yes, and that's exactly what I was saying here. That's exactly what's going to happen here, even if we don't have. Yes, and that happens in the toy model where there's no uncertainty, which is essentially my version here of Barrow Becker. The thing here, as he pointed out, is that we're looking at that particular mechanism of uncertainty in fertility, and what people can do in order to get around that uncertainty. And then I'm going to use my model as a measurement device to figure out the importance, the quantitative importance of those things. That's what I'm going to do. Right. And as I said in the beginning, this is very much work in progress. I'm going to show you some counterfactuals to get those numbers that I showed you in the introductory slide. But we have way more things that we want to use to for this model, the different policies that we could explore with this model.
So the comparison you want to make between the towing model and this one, between the barrel backer and, in other words, if you talk about the value added allowing for uncertainty and contraception, it's that comparison to your framework. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah, that's right. As I said, the toy model is essentially a version of Barrow Becker. Okay, so I mean, we have a standard stationary competitive equilibrium. There's nothing really to show. I mean, people do their thing; they maximize given prices. Everyone does that, and all markets clear. Okay. So we're going to calibrate this model to the Kenyan data. Again, it's a country that fits our purposes. And we're going to do some counterfactual experiments. I'm going to show you just a couple, really, because you know, I'm showing the calibration. I mean, the computer is running. So I'll show you some experiments which are going to be very, very stark experiments. And then we can discuss a little bit.
So you could also look for a country which experimented with some big family planning. Project.
Like China.
Well, yeah, not as extreme as China, but
yeah.
Many of these countries had interventions, I assume, over the years, supported by some international organizations. So Kenya, does Kenya fit that criteria?
I can't tell you of one particular thing that they did, but what that's going to be, anything that they have done in Kenya, my model is going to capture through these guys, right? And then essentially what I'm going to do today is just mess around with them. That's all I'm going to do. But yeah, I can do any type of policy which we have not done yet. OK, so this is the model fit for Kenyan data. So blue is the model. Orange-ish is the data. So this is the distribution of education. So this is years of education, 0 to 4, 4 to 8, so on and so forth. This is the fraction of people in each bin, in each education bin. The model matches it. Okay.
How does your model produce these years? So we must make, we must assume something to make it comparable, because your model is a.
So remember that education thing that I showed you? I'm just restricting this to be five different beans. No education, that's fine. That's it. Yeah. Okay, so this is education. Here's fertility. So remember, the data is the orange. So you have a big decline here from 6.5 kids down to 3. So the model does generate decline, but not as steep as the data. But it does decline considerably by more than 2 kids. So this is unwanted fertility. So here the model has a little bit of a worse fit. Because in the data, it's kind of like this inverse U here. The very poor people here, there might be some people bringing this unwanted fertility down, because their unwanted fertility may go in the other direction. And I don't have that in the model.
When you say model fit, I'm not exactly sure how you're fitting the model. You didn't give it, so you have a set of moments, I guess.
Yes, these are the moments. I should have said that. So I have.
Moments, I mean, you're using these moments jointly. I'm just a weird reading.
Okay, let me tell you, I should have slides on that. So what we're doing is that we have 10 parameters. That we calibrate in this model, some preference parameters there in the utility function, also these prices here of abortions, the contraception, actually, this is normalized to 1 because there's another. Anyway, think about that. We calibrate these prices here and some utility parameters So we have 10 parameters that we calibrate, and we hit 20 moments. We try to hit 20 moments at the same time, jointly. And these are the moments that I'm going to show you now. Okay. So I showed education, fertility. This is unwanted fertility. This is abortions by education of the parents. And unwanted fertility, if anything, I mean, we over-predict here, but we under-predict a lot here. So there's a lot more unwanted fertility in the model than in the... There's a lot more unwanted fertility in the data than in the model.
And your definition of unwanted fertility in the model is the difference between what you want and the final outcome, or...?
Yes. So it's the difference between this and tilde here that I chose and the N that I ended up having.
After uncertainty and abortion.
After everything. Essentially, as you're saying, that this guy here would be a function of the human capital of the parents.
Yes. That's exactly what the code says.
Could do that. Yeah, I could do that. I could do that. I need to think about the calibration stuff, but yeah, I could do that. And this is the last graph. This is contraceptive use by the education of the parents, and which is increasing, not surprisingly, and the model delivers that too. And this is some aggregates. So this is the Gini coefficient. That's why the shock is also important to get to this guy. The years of education and the capital output ratio in the model and the data. Here, for the macroeconomists in the room, this looks very low just because it's 20 years worth of GDP. Okay, so as I said, I'm going to show you just very few counterfactuals, and there are going to be some very extreme versions. So here I have the benchmark. So here GDP is 1, capital stock is 1, and I have some of the things that I showed you before, 7.5 years of education, the Gini, the completed fertility is 5.5 children, and note that out of these 5.5, pretty much 1 is unwanted. And we also have the fraction of pregnancies aborted, which is 12% of all pregnancies are aborted. In the US, this number is higher. As I said, Georgi is our abortion expert. He says it's around 25%. And the last thing I want to say, this average lifetime utility here is as naive as it can get. So first, this is in utils. This is some ex ante utility that I'm just averaging over. And This is some, there's an endogenous population here. I'm not taking into account the people that weren't born or anything like that, which, you know, I could. Michelle, Mike Golozov's and Larry Jones' paper gives me some idea of that. I'm not doing any of that. Here is just like, utils just see the direction where this thing goes. So this is very naive. So the first thing that I'm going to do is what I said in the beginning is like, what if these guys could not, what if there was no uncertainty and these guys could perfectly choose the number of children? So essentially, I'm taking here and going toward Barrow Becker. There's no uncertainty here. So what we see is that the GDP per capita goes up 13%. And what happens is that this, let me talk about fertility first. So fertility goes down. Unwanted fertility, by construction, of course, goes to 0. And then what these guys do is that they have less kids, but they also educate them more. So average education in the economy goes up by about 1 year. The capital stock also goes up, and these two things add up to a higher GDP per capita. So this was the number I showed you in the beginning. So going from the benchmark Kenyan economy to a world in which you perfectly choose the number of children, would increase GDP per capita by 13%.
So part of this utility gain is because you don't experience this utility cost of having abortions. And part
yeah.
of this income.
Right.
Can you separate that? Or, because it depends on those parameters. If those parameters are very big, then you get lots of gain from just not letting people abort versus actual income gains. I mean, given the increasing use of education, I guess you get lots of income game, but it'll be good to know how much it
costs. That's a very good point. It would go up. I don't have the number here. And then again, it's util, so, but yes, it would go up. But yeah, maybe I should report that one. Yeah.
But there's also removal of uncertainty, right? In addition to what you're saying. I mean, now you're in a certain environment. You're perfectly certain in this environment.
Yes.
So any shocks, any kind of disutility associated with the curvature and the utility function?
Yes. Yes.
No, it's different.
I guess what Nezi is worried about is just those two parameters that these guys don't have to suffer anymore because they don't need to. And then I can, yes. Okay, so this is the no fertility shocks case. Now let's go to the other extreme in which these guys have no family planning whatsoever. And to answer your earlier question again, here is just that they have no access to abortions or contraception. They can still choose the entilda, as I call it, which is the unwanted, the wanted fertility. So completed fertility goes up to 6 children, and a huge number of these are unwanted. Of course, there's no abortions. These guys cannot abort by assumption. And the education goes down about 1 year. Capital stock also goes down. And that leads to a fall of also 13% in per capita GDP. And the number I showed you in the first slide was this number divided by this number, which is 30%. So going from a world, from these two extreme worlds in which there's no family planning whatsoever to a world that that you can perfectly choose the number of children, GDP per capita would increase by 30%.
Okay, very little action in income inequality, but Gini is tricky, so you might want to.
Yes. That's exactly what we want to do, because if you remember the bottom here, they have a very big unwanted fertility, and then I'm with those experiments I'm playing around with these guys, that's exactly what we want to do. The Gini just aggregates too much, right? Okay.
So you're assuming something about the spousal discordance that you're kind of abstracting away from all of that, and the disability you might get if your husband is unhappy despite you using contraception. So it's also like there's some evidence on the exam, for example.
Yes. So first of all, there's no disagreement here. It's a unitary model. Sorry, but yeah, there's no disagreement here. So given that there's no disagreement, any disutility of contraception is going to show up in those parameters that Nezi was talking about. Okay. So I'm going to just show you two more slides. So I think I'll even finish ahead of time.
Can I ask you,
yes.
So you have in the data, I never seen that. I thought it's monotonic. As you increase the education of the parents, the amount of fertility goes down. Every chart I've seen. But if you go back to your data, there is this inverted U shape. I think you mentioned.
This one.
Why so low for 0 to 4?
That's what I was telling her. I think it might be these guys are. There are not a lot of people here, right? So there are like 15% of people in this. So these are the very, 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 very poor people. So here, these guys are, some of these guys may be making mistakes on the other side. They want to have kids, but they don't. So their unwanted fertility is negative.
In the VHS, you have the ability to see all the birds and the ones that survive, right? The ones that survive.
Yeah.
So is this just including that?
That's including that, but I don't have the number exactly. For example, what the fraction of people that are in this bin here that have that this number is negative. I mean, I have it, but I don't remember. In fact, yeah. Always, my model is not going to generate this inverse U-shaped. So at some point, we just aggregated these two guys. We didn't. Here, it's disaggregated, and that's it. We don't generate that, but that's how the data looks like. OK. So the other statement I made in the introduction was the relative effectiveness, if you will, of I didn't put contraception here, of abortions versus contraception. So here I'm going to do something very simple, which is I'm just going to make either abortions or contraception free for everyone. Okay? I'm going to leave the disutility. Free in terms of, that was the question, right?
Yes.
Yeah, the monetary, the price of these things are going to go to zero. So that's why if I made everything zero, these guys would perfectly ensure that that's the end of the story. So here for abortions, so remember that completely insuring against of this shock. So if I made everything, as in everything, even the utility cost zero, this is what we were going to have. So that's, for example, the GDP per capita would go up by 13%. Here it goes up by 9%. The average years of education increases slightly less, and everything is not as much as before. The unwanted fertility goes down by half, and not surprisingly, the fraction of pregnancies aborted more or less doubles.
The cost of abortion, you take that from the data, or are you calibrating that?
We calibrate that.
So how do you separately identify the disutility?
Yes. Data? So by trying to get this right. Because the monetary value and the utility value is going to look different for these types of people, and for both, yeah.
Yeah, but it looks like you need to make, it will be easier time, also give you a bit more richness if these costs were more of a distribution. All depends on your characteristics, the choice,
I don't like that point because you have a nice interpretation that if I reduce the cost of like the pill from by 10%, then
right,
no,
just
the cost, yes,
yeah.
But the utility cost,
yeah.
could be
no, the utility
distribution,
yeah.
And then you know if you could pin down that it's in micro data, that could be
okay.
Bad, yeah.
I could do that. Yeah, I could think about doing that. Okay. So so this is the free abortions case. So abortions, and here, so okay, so going back to Chris' question, the or Nezi, I don't remember now. Here I don't take these things straight out of it. I do compare the prices I get to some measures in the data, but things that we were thinking about is that okay, you are in the middle of nowhere in Kenya, and even though there might be some clinic that gives you free pills in the city, there's some extra cost associated with that. And then kind of like, so I can tell you that our price, I mean, I don't have it here, but our prices are similar to the prices we get there, but we just didn't want to take that price. It doesn't make a whole lot of difference because our prices are similar. Okay, so this is what happens to free abortions, and with free contraception, essentially you go to the free, almost to the free, to the no uncertainty scenario, and what this is saying just is that that utility cost for contraception that we calibrate is very low. So for the utility cost for abortion is higher, so that's why these guys do increase their abortion use, but not too much, whereas contraception, these guys just do a lot more. Now these are very stark experiments, right? We're making it free for everyone. And by the way, I didn't put here, but we could also compute the cost of these things because I have the price and I have the use, which we haven't done yet. But what we're trying to do is, you said, as you were worried about the left tail of the distribution, we're thinking about, well, what if you target those guys, right? And also what we want to do is that, remember, we also have the price of education, and then we can also you can subsidize contraception. That's one way of doing things. The other way is to subsidize education. In a cost neutral way, we can do all of that, but we haven't done yet. Yes.
So have you thought about trying to differentiate between different types of contraception? So, I mean, there are obvious more important health consequences if you use condoms rather than using the pill. And especially in sub-Saharan Africa, you may want also to take that into account and think about it.
Yeah, we did think about that. So here, the way we're doing, so we have, you pay some price, which actually, you pay some price and there's some effectiveness of contraception, right? So the price is actually one. So it's the effectiveness that measures. So it's like dollars into pregnancies prevented, if you will. And then we just take, and we calibrate that guy. So for example, we don't see, well, you have all of the different options and you'd have different effectiveness and utility costs and things like that. We did not do that. We thought about doing that, but we didn't. And I don't think.
I mean, if you're using DHS, you have the data.
We have the data. Yeah. The data for contraception is very good. The data for abortions is that it's. Yeah. Okay. So that's it. So as I said, I mean, these I've just shown you some very stark experiments. Right now, we're thinking about more reasonable ones. But the question that we're after here is that what's the impact, the quantitative impact of unwanted fertility on development, in particularly looking through that mechanism, the role of contraception in abortion? Yeah?
So back to Jim's question about where does this, how does this differ from Becavero? Is one way to think of this is just Becavero, but investigating in detail the mechanism by which knowledge gets translated into decisions or changes in fertility?
Yes, which is what you said a few minutes ago. Yes. So if one way of doing things in the Barrow-Becker world is just the cost of children, as he said, right? Here's just like, okay, let's look at this thing in particular and see what's the impact of that. That's exactly what it is.
It's important in policy, the trade-offs between contraception versus abortion.
Right.
Or
education. That's exactly what we're doing, yes. So anyway, I mean, that's it. We use a general equilibrium model to assess this. These results, at least the extreme results, seem that the quantitative effects may be very different, very important, as going from no family planning to a perfect planning world would increase GDP per capita by 30%. And of course, we're thinking about more interesting policy experiments. Now that we have the model, let's make the model work.
But how does the model say, in terms of just following what Tom was saying, differ in the sense of what the predicted elasticity would be of response of fertility to an increase in the wage, okay, the opportunity cost of time. If W goes up in your setup,
yeah,
with and without the abortion technology, so under the perfect certainty world and without, how much does that modify or extend the wage effect? Do you have any sense of that? Just the response, these other kinds of more traditional kind of arguments about fertility.
Right. I know your question. I mean, I can tell you right now quantitatively what this is doing. I mean, we have this effect, but I can tell you right now. I didn't look at that person. But yeah, I can do that for sure.
And then just the general income effect. I mean, just a wealth effect. So suddenly the economy is given an endowment, say, a capital, or maybe given just an endowment.
Of TFP goes up.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Exactly. Again, how this modification would affect what you get.
Yeah, and that's actually one of the experiments we want to do. I think Nazi asked, or you asked, that we were, I was going to focus on one country only. We can even do like a cross-country thing by messing around with the TFP, a very naive one, by messing around with the TFP.
It's kind of what would happen if we were improved or some kind of technical change.
Yeah, definitely, yes.
Okay, any further questions? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.